Thank you very much, Anne. And it's great to be here. I was here yesterday, and I must say it's a very engaging and a very exciting conference. So I'm delighted to be able to speak. As Anne mentioned, we've had lots of conversations in coffee shops over the last little while about it. We thought it would be very useful to share with you a project that's a national level project. As Anne said, the National Forum is a national agency to enhance teaching and learning. So it's coming at it from the teaching and learning level for universal design. Level one in looking at the inclusive assessment document, the UDL guidelines, the license to learn. I think I'm correct with the. Looking at it from an inclusive assessment piece. So we felt it was very valuable to fill you in on a national project, because I think this can help actually when you're dealing with your students or as students where you need to kind of know, well, do you know, this is happening nationally, so this is kind of an important agenda. So we felt it might be quite useful to fill you in on the work we're doing in the National Forum around inclusive assessment. The title, I suppose, of the talk is Students as Partners, and this also resonates a lot with the Universal Design piece, and again, looking at the license to learn document yesterday, the students themselves talk to themselves as needing to be partners in this process. So I wanted to fill you in on work that we're doing, trying to involve students as partners in assessment and feedback. So it's a sectoral level approach and an approach to try and change practice. So how does it fit with universal design? Well, when you look at universal design and you look, I mean, learner variability, diverse learners, diverse cohorts, it was talked about a lot yesterday that it's a huge diversity, not just disability, but international students, students from different backgrounds, mature students. There's a hugely diverse student population now, both in higher and in further education. And one of the principles, as you all know, speaking to the converted, around universal design is this principle of providing multiple means of engagement. And this really fits nicely with this particular piece. And within that, students as partners is an important aspect. In relation to the National Forum, we are running an enhancement theme. An enhancement theme is a two-year project that we give attention to for 2 years at a national level. And this time around, between 2016 and 2018, assessment and feedback is the enhancement theme. So we really wanted to push this agenda, this very important agenda for students, which is assessment and feedback. And one of the key aspects of this enhancement theme has been the idea of assessment as and for learning. And I'll come back to the definition of that in a few minutes. But a big part of this a definition of assessment is students as self-regulated learners. So students being able to judge their own work, being able to judge how they are doing, and giving students that power and that skill, which is a really, really important life skill in relation to assessment. So, and students as partners in this is an important process. So the enhancement theme, as I say, this two-year national project was looking at assessment of, for, and as learning. And what they mean, those terms mean, assessment of learning is the summative assessment that we all know, and the students will say, it's the graded assessment that goes into students' transcripts, that they get at the end of the year that allows them to progress. So we all recognise that as the graded high-stakes assessment that students and staff are caught up with. Assessment for learning is that extension that assessment is also not just for judgment and progression purposes and making sure people have attained the skills, but it's around it's about enhancing their learning. It's around feedback on their learning so that they know how well they're doing and so that they can, again, I suppose, understand their learning and know their learning. So assessment for learning has the feedback aspect is really, really important. So giving feedback to students, okay? A very important aspect of assessment. We mightn't always see it as assessment, but it is assessment in the broadest sense, in that it's allowing students to judge themselves and to be able to be judged. So assessment for learning, a big aspect of it is feedback. Feedback to students. Assessment as learning is a little bit of an extension of that. And assessment as learning is the idea of, well, you can give feedback to students, But sometimes they don't understand the feedback, or this feedback's the wrong timing. So assessment as learning takes it that step further, and this is a big part of this project, which is where students can use the information or have opportunities to self-assess and self-regulate so that they know how well they're doing themselves. Really important skill for life, for employability, for enhancing their learning. So it's a really, really important skill. So the first thing in this project was that assessment isn't as simple as it looks. There's a much wider understanding of what we mean by assessment. Okay. So I think why was a big question yesterday, like why universal design? Why students as partners? Why push this agenda? Why would, apart from the students feeling they should be empowered, why this agenda? If you look at some of the comments that I would typically hear, and you would probably typically hear yourself, around the assessment agenda, particularly in higher education, you often hear comments such as the comments up here. Some of the staff views you might hear are, well, I don't have time to give good feedback. I'm under pressure. I don't have time. You know, I'm teaching. I've got 500 in my class. I've got 100 in my class. I've got big classes. I don't have time to give good feedback. I'm under pressure. So that's something you hear a lot. And I think that was mentioned yesterday a lot, that there's the idea of that staff are under pressure and how can they give feedback. You'll often hear staff saying, well, I give feedback, I do my essays and I do lots of feedback and I leave them for the students to collect. And, you know, a lot of students don't come and collect it. So what's going on there? There's something happening around maybe students not collecting feedback. What is that about? I mean, you hear staff saying that sometimes students don't collect feedback. Students won't do it if it's not assessed. If I don't assess it, students won't do it. You hear that kind of language. From staff. So I have to assess them and they won't turn up or they won't do it and I have to keep assessing. And there's this kind of frantic, you know, sort of competition nearly to get students' attention around assessment. So that's quite a strong sort of driver and sort of a view you hear from staff. Some of the comments you might hear from students are things like, well, I don't understand the feedback. You know, think critically or, you know, put together a more critical argument. What does that mean? What does that mean for me? I don't understand what they mean. You know, put together a more coherent argument around this or even referencing or whatever. Since students may not understand the feedback. Students might say, well, I've no choice in my assessment. I'm given the exam. I don't have any choice. I don't have any control over this. And then you'll hear things like staff will often hear and students will often say, well, you know, as staff are talking, they're saying, well, is it on the exam? You know, do I need to learn it? Is it on the exam? So I'm painting probably quite a negative picture here. I'm probably putting the challenge as opposed to the answers. But that's the kind of language that you might hear. So there's something not quite right in assessment in higher education. And I suppose this project was trying to look at what maybe we could do about it. There's a lot of detail here about the project, and I don't want to kind of market the project that's gone on, but I'll just give you a flavour of what's happening in it, and then I'll give you some of the key messages that are coming from it that I think that you'd be more interested in. But we've run 75 assessment seminars across the Irish higher education sector around assessment. Lots of stuff around inclusive design was in there, but lots of from peer self and self-assessment, grading, programme assessment, work assessment, authentic assessment. We have a professional development framework for some of you who are interested in the professional development, the CPD of staff. We have a brand new professional development framework, which is for all staff who teach. So anybody who is teaching. So disability officers who are teaching might look at it for yourselves, for academic staff, for educational technologists. So and within that framework, we talk a lot about students as partners, diverse student cohorts. So there's a big agenda with the professional development piece in relation to the National Forum. We're looking at what we mean by assessment. I'll come back to that. We're students as partners, and we've worked with the student group, and I'll come back to that. We're looking at approaches to program assessment, and we're particularly looking with different stakeholders around authentic and work-based assessment. So there's a lot going on, okay? So I don't want to bore you with all the details, and I'm very happy to talk about it, but there's lots of stuff going on. I'm talking today, so I'm meeting yourselves today. I'm very happy to continue the conversation. I've talked with Anne about this, and some of you yesterday, that happy to talk through this conversation further with yourselves as a group. But I suppose, what are the key messages coming out from this? There's a couple of key messages coming around from all the different activity. First of all, we need to understand assessment and feedback better. We need some ideas to develop students as partners. We need to look at assessment overload and the impact that's having. And if that's having it on all students, it's certainly having it on students with disabilities. But that is a big issue coming through. And we need more integrative, diverse, and authentic assessments. Okay, so these are the four key messages. I'm just going to talk to these four messages and see how they relate to yourselves. The first thing is we need a better understanding of feedback. I've started to talk a little bit about this. What do we mean by assessment? What does it mean? So we're working on a draft definition of this, which we will have by the end of this month, and we'll share back with you. And the idea is if we have a better understanding of this spectrum of what we mean by assessment, we can interrogate this in a much better way, okay? So we will have a working definition for the Irish higher education sector, working along with QQI and working we've done a lot of consulting around this. And just very briefly, because we'll send you all the link afterwards to it, because this is a draft working definition. But those of you who know assessment know summative, which is the demonstrating of learning, the formative, which is around feedback, and the teacher is more responsible probably in the graded summative assessment, and the student becomes a little more responsible in the other types. And as I mentioned before, there is the for and as is down in the formative space, and as being around the self-regulatory piece, which is coming through a lot in the universal design literature. This idea of student regulation is coming through a lot in it. So we really, really do overlap with universal design, particularly in that piece, and to give and receive feedback. So just to give you some examples of this, because I think these might be useful for you in your practices, that you might consider this, and many of you may be doing this. And the slides are available for because it might be hard enough to read there, but the slides are available. But some of the key ones maybe I want to pull out. The high stakes one is the graded end of semester one. We all know that one. But to pull out some different ones, the low stakes, the top, this one here, which is the, I suppose, low stakes graded assessment. These are assessments that maybe get a mark, but there might be 10% or 5%. I think Sumi, and I don't know if she's still here today, is she? Talked about yesterday from UCD, you know, some of the online stuff that they were doing, the quizzes, and that they get a quick feedback. They are actually very useful. They are actually graded, but they are very useful in relation to forms of feedback. So they're low stakes, graded, but they're very, very valuable in relation to maybe giving students feedback. The danger is when we get so many of them that students feel overloaded. So there's balances in this. The other piece that I'd like to maybe draw your attention to is this one here. This idea that students don't look at feedback sometimes, that they don't understand it or they don't pick it up. Why is that? Sometimes it can, so this one here, for those who can't read it, students request feedback based on their self-monitoring. This is a really nice little idea or technique that maybe some of you use. The idea that students request the feedback. Okay, so when they hand in an assignment, and I did this myself with students myself, they're handing an assignment, they say, I'd like feedback on whatever. It might be referencing. It might be what's critical thinking. It might be, you know, the structure. And at least then students are taking some ownership, some partnership in what they get feedback on. Better use of staff time, better use of students' time. It'll be read and at least the effort in it. So those, that kind of thing is really important, the overlap between kind of for and as. These ones here, again, are actually very, very valuable. These are where students do stuff. And again, some people mentioned them yesterday. I think Marion McCarthy, she in the room, mentioned yesterday about, yes, about students self-reviewing against criteria, peer reviewing against criteria on their own work. So it can be done in class. Staff can set it up. Good use of staff time. Very good use of students' time. So they're critically evaluating their own work and making judgments against either kind of more analytical criteria, which is that more matrixy type one, or more holistic criteria. So ideas around that for really pushing this idea of students as partners in it. The other thing that's really, really important in relation to this idea of students as partners is, and again, it was mentioned yesterday, the importance of peers. I think the student, Nora, that people saw in the video yesterday. She talked a lot about, my God, I learned a lot from having an opportunity to work with peers. So that really, this idea of students helping to get self-regulating by actually talking to their peers, having opportunity, is assessment. Okay, it's not maybe what we think is assessment, and this is why we need to change our understanding of assessment. Assessment is the opportunity to judge your work and judge yourself. So it is a form of assessment. So this idea, again, to go back to it, that students can develop this sort of mirror of looking at themselves, judging their own work, is really, really important. And it is giving more ownership to the students and more sort of power to students. It's written a lot about in the international literature, in the teaching and learning literature, and in the universal design kind of literature as well. Oh, sorry, wrong one. So just a couple of ideas. We met with the students as part. We met with the USI, which is the Union of Students of Ireland, to ask what they thought about assessment. And they gave us some really, really nice ideas around students as partners. They talked about what staff can do, and they talked about what they can do. And again, if students as partner, what can they do? So a couple, maybe pull out a few of these. The staff can, maybe just pulling a few, the staff can, the one I love, give students a choice of assessment methods. Okay, allowing them some choice. So students, choice for all. Level one in the inclusive assessment piece on page 63 of that nice new license to learn document, where students have opportunity to choose, maybe from not too big a choice, two or three, and it is a choice for all. Opportunities to self and peer assess, I mentioned that one. But students talked about things like, well, we need to take responsibility. We need to get involved in assessment at institutional level for those that are in that position. We need to be informed of our role and be informed of what we have to do. We need to take responsibility for learning our assessment, what we have to do. We have to plan our assessment load. So it's about students themselves saying, we need to take responsibility too. So this is from the students. The third message that I suppose I'd like to maybe talk a little bit about is this idea that was coming through a lot about assessment overload. There is this balance between a lot of this activity where I have to give some grading to the students so they won't turn up, or I'm giving it for very good reasons, such as feedback, and so they know how well they're doing. But when everybody is doing it, and everybody, when you multiply it, particularly in the higher education context with modularization, it becomes to be a little bit of an overload. And so students are struggling and staff are struggling with this kind of rat race, for want of a better word. So there's a really nice description of this by Tony Harland, who's New Zealand, who will be over here actually in October. We might get to meet him in a minute. And he talks about the idea of developing slow time for students and staff, time to actually take stock of what you need to do. The idea of slow time. And one of the pieces of research that the National Forum has done in relation to this assessment project, we did a cross-section of about 500 modules, 30 undergraduate programs. And one of the pieces in relation to overload, which is very interesting for those of you involved in design and module design. I know we have a mixture here of academic staff, disability officers, and different. But just to flag this, is that we found in this research, in the Irish research, that if staff had 2 5 credit modules, okay, that's 10 UK credits for the UK people in the audience, there was equivalent to about 5.2 graded assessments, okay? If they had a 10 credit module, it was equivalent of 2.8. So it's meant to be the same. It's student effort hours, ECT credits, but the smaller the module doesn't mean less assessments. That's a big implication at an institutional and national level in relation to curriculum design, in relation to overload, which has a big impact on all students. And as I say, I'm sure in particular an impact on students who are struggling in the system with some of the assessments. So really important to know this as part of the national project and really important to do something about it. But just watch that, and it is something. So really, students need to, I'll read it out because I think it's a very nice description of the idea of slow scholarship, slow thinking around this place. Students were so busy with assessment requirements that they had little space and time for thinking or doing any study outside of assessed course requirements. The need to grade had led to fragmentation of experiences and the miniaturization of knowledge as learning happening in micro modules. Neither students nor lecturers were entirely happy with this situation. So there's something going on in Irish higher education. I think maybe further education might be a bit better in this space, but talking to some of my colleagues earlier, but maybe. But certainly in the higher education sector, there's a lot of speed going on, a lot of fast time. So we need to really look at this at a national level. Okay, we are doing some work on putting together a nice resource which will be available at the end of March, and we'll share it back with you around some ideas at programme level. And again, maybe that's probably more for the people who are involved in this level, but I think it's important to be aware of it, that we need to look at programmatic assessment so that we can actually do something about this. And this does involve institutional leadership, it involves students becoming partners, and we've putting together some really nice case studies, both internationally and nationally, around how to improve the situation at programme level. So increasing diversity in the programme, increasing students as partners in the programme. Interesting thing about diversity, though, as well, it's really diverse assessment is really good, but too much diversity can equally be stressful. If a student is jumping from one module to the other, where there's a different assessment in every module, it's equally not particularly helpful. So there's a balance here about diversity across a programme that needs to take account of students building their experiences with assessment. So diversity is really important, but a kind of strategic approach to diversity in a programme is equally important, because too much diversity can equally be stressful. You may or may not agree with that one, but I think it's, we can chat afterwards. I suppose the kind of last message, how am I doing time-wise? But we're doing okay. The last, I suppose, message that was coming through is, I suppose, the nature of the types of assessment. There is a real need for a more integrative types of assessment, for more diverse assessments, and for more authentic assessments. Okay, they're the three things that are coming through in relation to types of assessments that we need. But they're needed to engage students, okay? This is about engaging students. I'll just talk very, I suppose, quickly about it. The integrative one, I know this is a bit of a blocky-looking graph, but the integrative one is one about, again, planning assessment at a program level. And it's the idea that students need a chance, time, to build skills through a program, okay? So students need assessments that aren't just jumping from small modules. They need assessments that build on previous years, okay, so that there's a really coherent feel to how a student might. So take, for example, group work. I was talking to people just beforehand. You know, group work is an assessment that students hate or love. It's a really, really challenging one. And one of the reasons is that students are thrown into group work. Or they need group work, it's a life skill, they need to do it, they learn from the peers, it's really great. And you talk to students, they hate group work, or they've had a great experience, or hate group work. So, and one of the reasons is that it hasn't been built. There hasn't been an incremental feel to it. They haven't had a chance, maybe in first year, to be in a group, but maybe just get a small assessment for just being there. And then build slowly to kind of group assessment by the end that has actually you know, build on these skills of group work. So it needs an integrative approach for all students in the curriculum. It needs to look at integration between modules. So it needs to look at how we integrate our understanding what's going on around, not just this kind of feel that we're on a conveyor belt. The student portfolio, again, is a really nice assessment that builds on students' unique learning opportunities and is an important one across the programme. So real need for integrative. To talk a bit about diversity, as part of that research that we did on the nearly 500 modules, you won't be able to see the small print, but you don't need to. I'll give you the essence on the slides are there, but I'll talk a little bit to it in my 1 minute, maybe. We tried to get a sense of the diversity of assessment across the Irish higher education sector in these 500 modules. I don't think you need to even see the print to work out which is the light blue. What would you say the assessment is the light blue? Well done. So you can see, and these are the different fields of study in our the different disciplines. I know the next speaker is from education. You'll be pleased to education is not doing too bad in this space. Education has actually, these are the top four assessments that during the disciplines. So light blue being exam. Very high in businesses, natural sciences. The dark blue is essay, very common in the kind of human sciences. The grey is kind of lab work. The orange is kind of project-based stuff. So they're the top four. The blank is other different diversities. So if you see the blank at the top, it means education is doing quite a lot of other types of assessments. And when you look at these, you know, the variety is less. So there's common assessments, but the exam is still being done by 61% of the modules. Okay, so that's a lot of exams, which I know leads to a lot of special accommodations, but leads to a lot of issues. It doesn't suit a lot of learners. And again, I don't have to convince yourselves as an audience about that one. So we need different varieties of assessments. And really, I suppose what this project is highlighting is what's out there. And we need to really come and really develop more diverse assessments. One particular type being more authentic assessments. And again, linking with the idea of engagement. Authentic assessments being assessments that are more real world, more true to life, that students recognize as being something of what they're going to be doing, either in life or in work. So authentic assessments are, the context is really important. Anne mentioned the context. Students are center of it. It involves a task. And I suppose to give you an example from something was my background way back, which was health sciences. So instead of, you know, a student's having to sit and examine and write the signs and symptoms of, say, rheumatoid arthritis, they develop a student's information leaflet around rheumatoid arthritis. That kind of idea. So they know they're going to be practicing in healthcare, they know they're going to be dealing with patients, and isn't that something that they know that would be useful for a patient? And yet it's still getting the signs and symptoms of rheumatoid arthritis. So it's those types of assignments that are more authentic for students and more valuable. And there's lots of nice examples of that. So I suppose, just time-wise, I suppose the couple of key messages that are coming from this national project are we need to have a wider, better understanding of what assessment and feedback mean. It's not, and actually yesterday, feedback to the student was mentioned a lot, and I suppose I would challenge that a little bit. I think because if you're having students as partners, it is about them trying to develop their responsibility in this. It is about them trying to look for the types of feedback and actually getting ways to actually get them more students as partners in the feedback process. So the idea of students as partners, I mentioned a few ideas there from the students themselves at the Union of Students of Ireland, choice of assessment, them getting more responsible, them becoming part of this process. We need to look at assessment overload and what it's doing in the Irish higher education sector. We need to look at more integrated, diverse and authentic assessments. And I suppose my final thing would be to say, like, we need to come at this. We all need to come a little bit out of our practices, I think, and we need to, how do we actually get to, I think Katie Novak was talking yesterday, the multi-tiered approach, the leadership. How do we actually all come up a step in this? How do we become partners? How do we push this agenda of actually developing students as partners? What part do we have to play in it? And I suppose knowing that these are national issues and they would also ring with international practices from the literature, how can you, I will put the question, how can you help to make sustainable changes to this assessment of for and as learning in your institution, for your students, and how can you become, I suppose, a partner in this change, in this piece? So thank you very much. Do you want any questions? Yeah, does anybody have any questions? Do we have time for some questions?
Very good.
Yes, somebody at the back.
Thanks, Geraldine, for that. My name is Sean Bracken from the University of Worcester. And I'm really interested in how you're going to take the learning from this project.
Yeah.
Into actually impacting practically within individual universities.
Yeah,
particularly in relation to leadership and getting that leadership buy-in.
Yeah. We have a couple of different ways we're doing it. It's a two-year project, so there's a lot been going on to date with the different, you know, we have met a lot of staff, but we have a couple of different things that we're doing to try and keep it sustainable. We're working closely with the QQI on this space, so we're working with the kind of the bodies. I suppose that's the one thing about when you're in something like the National Forum, you do get to work, you know, with that kind of partners. We are developing leadership work in our pilot study in the professional development. So we're working with the leaders. So sustainably over time, it's not going to happen yet. Again, to use Katie Novak's, it's going to be a slow time. We're developing a digital badge in relation to program assessment for leaders, for specific, again, for leaders. So we're really trying to push, and I suppose the resources that we have been developing over the last, I suppose, couple of months since I've been involved in it, we are bringing these back to kind of the senior people in the institutions. So we have a long, it was kind of a short-term piece where we're meeting people in the current institutions, and a more long-term plan, which is in relation to professional development of senior staff. The professional development framework particularly is developing that piece. Digital badges around program assessment. So we're trying to think about sustaining this over the time. But it's not going to change overnight. Graded high-stakes assessment is there and needs to be there. But we do need to try and shift what's going on, I think, a little bit in higher education. So that's the, does that answer your question? Yeah.